Puru, I'd like to ask you about one company in particular because it does have exposure to a number of these different areas that you discuss. I mean, whether or not we're talking about AI, EVs, robotics, and that's Tesla. On the day that you and I are speaking, it's October 24th, Tesla is up almost 19%, seeing a big pop. It did see a little bit of a decline after their most recent WeRobot event. But what are your thoughts on Tesla? Because this is a company that we've discussed with you in the past, of course, given the fact that, you know, they do have their humanoid robots. They're able to walk, they're able to maneuver. So what are your thoughts on Tesla?
Well, Tesla is one of our holdings in our portfolio. We think Tesla has a bright future. It is by far one of the biggest players in the EV space globally. It's a fantastic product. The car is very good. And, you know, the big story for Tesla is not really the autonomous driving or the robotaxis, although I think though they will be a meaningful business segment. What really excites me about Tesla is the Optimus, the humanoid robots opportunity, because I think Tesla has the AI capability. It has a visionary leader in the form of Elon Musk, you know, one of the greatest minds of our generation and an extremely smart businessman. He has the knowledge, the tech prowess, you know, a fantastic team. And I think Tesla is going to be one of the biggest companies in the world in the next 10 years, if not the biggest company, because, you know, they've got their hands or their fingers in so many different pies. They have got, you know, electric vehicles, EVs, autonomous driving technology, robot taxis coming online in the next few years, humanoid robots, and not to mention the energy business. So, you know, at the moment, the market is going gaga over Nvidia, but I think Tesla is going to be a big player in the future in all of these important industries. And the Tesla business has been a bit under the pump over the last couple of years simply because of very high interest rates, which made car, you know, financing quite expensive. But as, you know, Tesla pointed out in the earnings release today, you know, they're expecting a significant uptick in deliveries next year as the economy accelerates and the Fed eases policy. So I think, you know, it's not a software company, so you don't have recurring revenues. You know, they do sell one-time big-ticket items or hardware in the form of the cars. Eventually, one could argue that at least a portion of their revenue and cash flows would be generated by, you know, the licensing of the FSD and them running their own robotaxi fleets, which are going to be high-margin businesses for Tesla. But for the time being, you know, it is an auto OEM and, you know, subject to the cyclicality of the auto industry. But I do think that Tesla is going to be a big player. You know, it may have periods of sluggish growth, or, you know, it would be more susceptible to the swings in the economy than, say, a software company. But by and large, I'm pretty optimistic about Tesla. I think if they, you know, execute and if they play their cards right, then there is a real likelihood that this will probably become the most valuable business in the world.
Interesting. Yeah, I went and test drove a Tesla Model 3 Performance and fastest car I've ever driven in my life. 0 to 60 in 2.9 seconds. I was not prepared for that level of acceleration. And at that price point, I mean, it's amazing. But yeah, like you say, I mean, they're one of the industry leaders when it comes to humanoid robots. Eventually, as I believe you are correct, you know, we're going to be seeing these in people's households. It's probably not long from now. Of course, humanoid robots working in warehouses, that is something that's going to be inevitable. And it's amazing. One of the things that I think a lot of people don't understand is just how fast the developments are taking place with even battery technology too, because CATL, one of the main Chinese battery makers, BYD, both of them seeing major improvements in terms of charging times to make the range go longer and longer to make them lighter. Tesla's benefiting, many EVs are benefiting from that as well. What do you pay much attention to the battery technology or you know, some of the companies that are exposed in that area?
Yes, we do actually. We do follow the battery industry. You know, some of the names that you've mentioned, plus Tesla itself, you know, builds its own batteries. And then you've got QuantumScape in America, which
Right.
is trying to come up with solid-state lithium-ion batteries. And then some other players also are looking at new technologies to make the charging faster and the range longer. I mean, I've owned a Tesla Model 3 for a number of years, and I can attest to what you just said, that, you know, the pickup and the acceleration is just insane. You know, you leave a vast majority of the production cars behind when you, you know, accelerate from a traffic light. You know, even the, you know, some of the big sports cars are left behind. I mean, you honestly feel like a jolt to your body when you, you know, put your foot down on, in a Model 3
performance. It's like a roller coaster.
It is, yeah, it's incredible. And, you know, once you drive an electric car, you don't go back to your petrol car. You know, it's just so much, you know, hassle to own a gas car or a petrol car. You got to get it serviced, you got to get the oil changed, and you have to go to the pump and everything else. And here, you know, you just have a charger on your wall at home. You come home, you plug it in the morning, you're good to go. And there is no service, there's no oil change, no filter change, no gas, you know, petrol smell, no leakage, no oil leak, no, nothing of that sort. And it's just so convenient and it's good for the environment. And it's fun to drive. So, you know, I'm already converted to electric vehicles. You know, I'm not going to be driving a gas guzzler again in my life, I don't think. You know, I'm thinking of buying a new car now, and I'm contemplating which electric car to buy. So, you know, I'm converted already. I think, you know, electric vehicles will basically be present in most of the world, you know, and the US is sort of not at the forefront of this as much, because, you know, America has a lot of natural resources as far as, you know, oil reserves and stuff are concerned. And there is a big industry, oil industry in the US. So the conversion from gas, as you call it in the US, to electric hasn't been as good or as fast as some other countries in Europe or China, for instance. But I think, you know, ultimately, electric cars will represent a meaningful chunk of total cars in the US. It's just a matter of time.
Yeah, I think things are continuing to move in that direction, especially when we see, again, all the improvements that we're seeing in battery technology with increasing the range times, decreasing the charge time. And I think that people would be remiss if they're not paying attention to, of course, you and Alpha Target, with a lot of the research that you provide, you're front and center on making sure that people are aware of all of these things and looking at the very companies that are benefiting the most from that. So again, you know, as we close, just to summarize some of what you said, you think that we could be looking at a year-end rally here, given just the level of central bank easing that we see, global liquidity growth, very strong, that could continue into 2025 based on some of the research that you've been posting and that we discussed today. You think that if we did see a Trump win, that would be more pro-growth and perhaps benefit, you know, the small, maybe mid-cap sector, I believe you said a little bit more, but also lead to a powerful market rally. If Harris wins, it would be more concentrated into big tech, which is seen kind of as a safe haven asset or investment. And then, you know, a number of long-term investment themes here that you're focused on that we discussed, whether or not that is e-commerce, autonomous driving, humanoid robots, software. So with that said, what would be the best way for our listeners to gain access to your excellent research moving forward?
Well, Chris, we publish research on our website, which is alphatarget.com, alphatarget.com. So, I mean, the research is put out by our team of analysts working together. I also contribute to the research. I'm more of an editorial role and also writing, you know, the strategy and portfolio management and stuff, because we run our own portfolio. Also, I invest my own capital in the companies that we do the research on. So it's like, you know, running a little family office with my own capital, with a team of analysts, enjoying what we, you know, we're doing what we enjoy, getting paid for it and helping people. Publishing research. And, you know, we also post weekly updates. So we produce a monthly report at the beginning of each month with our full list of portfolio holdings and in-depth research reports on all the holdings. So this is just to give your, you know, listeners an idea. This is around 160 or 170 pages long, this monthly report. Then we publish a weekly update every Monday, covering the news flow of all the portfolio companies for the past week, giving our take on all the news releases. We cover all the earnings and so forth, which are released by our portfolio companies, provide analyst notes for our subscribers. We then also share our hedging indicators, our proprietary hedging indicators every week with our subscribers. And then we also put out trading alerts. So whenever we buy and sell anything for our own portfolio, or whenever our proprietary hedging indicators give us signals to buy or sell or to hedge the portfolio or to remove the hedge from the portfolio. We publish those, also share those moves with our subscribers by issuing trading alerts. And all this information is available on a subscription basis from alphatarget.com. We offer two subscriptions. One is an annual subscription, which is for $1,000 a year, or a monthly subscription, which is $100 a month. And you know, people can go onto the website. We have some free educational articles on our resources page on our website. You know, people can go and read, learn more about our philosophy, the way we invest, and our research service. And if they're interested, they can simply use the payment checkout on our website and subscribe, and immediately they will have access to the paid research area on the website.
Well, once again, we've been speaking with Puru Saxena. You can follow more of his work at alphatarget.com, or also follow him on X at Saxena_Puru. We'll have links out to both of those areas if you want to click the links if you're already on Financial Sense. Puru, always a pleasure to have you on. Thank you for sharing your outlook. It was a pleasure to speak with you. We definitely look forward to having you on the show in the future.
Thank you very much, as always, Chris. Very nice to talk to you. Thank you for having me on.
So as Puru said today, when we look at global liquidity indicators surging as global central banks around the world are cutting rates along with the expansion in real money growth, this is positive for the market and economic outlook moving forward. We will have some charts and data where this interview is located on Financial Sense if you want to take a look at these indicators for yourself. And when we also consider the fact that the U.S. government is spending $6.75 trillion in 2024 in order to keep the economy afloat, that is throwing some things out of whack and clearly having an impact. Given that, Puru believes that we are likely looking at a seasonal rally, especially post-election, once this uncertainty is behind us. He thinks that a potential win by Trump could trigger a significant risk-on rally in the market, as he is viewed by the foreign investment community as pro-growth. Meanwhile, despite Chinese stimulus efforts, foreign investor sentiment toward the Chinese market still remains low. He would not be allocating a large amount of capital to this area. Again, he is from Hong Kong, and that is where he resides. Some of the key investment themes that we discussed today are the ongoing AI capital expenditure boom, especially when we look at the number of data centers that are being built all around the globe, the benefits to software companies, especially if they're able to utilize AI agents, cross-border e-commerce, payments, robotics, and ongoing advancements in battery technology, making ranges longer, charging times shorter, and making batteries all the more lighter and easier to use for humanoid robotics. So those are some of the themes and items that we discussed today. If you have any questions or feedback on what we discussed with Puru Saxena, feel free to hit where it says contact us on financialsense.com, or you can always give us a call at 888-486-3939 if you'd like to learn more about what we are doing here at Financial Sense Wealth Management. For FS Insider, I'm Chris Sheridan. Thanks for listening.
Financial Sense News Hour is for informational and educational purposes only and should not be considered as a solicitation or offer to purchase or sell any securities. The investments, investment strategies, and investment philosophies discussed or presented on the News Hour each involve their own unique risk factors, which are not discussed on the show. Responses to listener inquiries are based on the personal opinions of the Financial Sense staff and do not take into account listener suitability, objectives, or risk tolerance. Financial Sense News Hour and its parent company shall not be liable for any financial losses that result from investing in any companies mentioned in Financial Sense or arising out of the use of any material on the News Hour. Be advised that you invest at your own risk.